All right, and we are back with part two of our Parasite discussion. We're here with Julia, my sister. Thank you for joining us.
You're welcome.
Yeah. You wanna move into our final section? We're talking about will be just some of our favorite parts of the movie, some of our least favorite parts in the movie.
Okay.
Just kind of. Like anything mm-hmm. that stuck out to you a lot, just anything at all.
So for me, the biggest thing that stuck out to me is in general the cinematography, right? The way it was filmed, right?
Oh yeah.
But more specifically, like going on the theme that the film like so like crucially emphasizes mm-hmm. is hiding, right?
Yeah.
I just love the like the doorway to the basement. It's Ooh. Just pitch black.
It is.
And when people go in, they just disappear. They and then do. Like when the guy comes up, he's kind of like, you know, like this monster coming into the light.
Yeah.
But also you see it again and again when the characters are hiding or they're like coming out of their hiding place mm-hmm. and they're like, can I come out? Can I like move? Like they yeah. like do this thing where like their fingers kind of like curl around. Yeah. The edges of it, and then they pop their head out, and they pop their whole body out. And I just really like that choreography of the actors and how, like, they how they moved through the film like that
yeah.
in those scenes, but also just the way it was filmed, the way that those scenes where they were supposed to be hidden
yeah,
was filmed. Because it feels like, because it's really supposed to give you that sense of, like, how people are parasites, right? But, like, yeah. kind of, like, animals or bugs
mm-hmm.
and that they're like vermin,
they're just kind of creepy.
Like they know
around.
They're not supposed to be there and they like are in the shadows, in the darkness, in the dark corners of the house or in the room and stuff like that. Because yeah. even like when the mom was joking with the dad, like, oh, if the Park family came back right now, well, they saw us like hanging out, you'd scatter like a cockroach like in our house when we turn on the lights.
Yeah.
And like that's exactly what happens to all of them.
Yeah, that's what
they scatter
yeah,
like cockroaches they and they start like freaking out.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and obviously that's like a very much like a human response, but the way it's filmed kind of emphasizes that yeah. point of like they're not, you know. How
it's like they constantly find themselves on the edge of hiding in the shadows, mm-hmm. but enough to see what's mm-hmm. happening in the
right,
light,
exactly.
you know,
yeah.
which I think is just such a great visualization mm-hmm. of everything mm-hmm. that occurs in this yeah. movie. I think for me, the cinematography, the visuals for me is mm-hmm. how angular it is.
Mm-hmm.
I love that.
Interesting.
I mean, granted, like you look at like this house that's been like built by this amazing architect mm-hmm. that's mentioned a couple times. I was expecting.
Mm-hmm.
for that line, like that little thread to go somewhere, but never kind of did. And I was like, oh man.
Yeah.
This film has a couple of those, honestly. You know, mm-hmm. there's a couple of arcs where I'm like, what?
Mm-hmm.
That's it? Like the son tutor and the girl he was tutoring. It just kind of like you do see that she ends up carrying him out and like saving him.
Right,
but
yeah.
past that, they no connection.
Mm-hmm.
Which I guess kind of makes sense.
Cause, yeah.
You know, y'all are getting murdered, but still. But, like, the fact that everything is shot, even, like, parts that aren't as pristine and angular as the mansion, but, like, the basement and then the semi-basement that the poor family lives in, the Kim family,
mm-hmm.
It's very angular, you know? It's the use of shapes, hallways, and the way it just frames a room. You know, mm-hmm. it's very angular, especially that
and
final...
And the light, and the use of
yeah,
light.
Yeah, the use of light, the use of green light.
Green light,
green
yeah, I was going to say, like, in the basement where it's all, like, green
ugly
and
dirty and...
Gross.
Yeah.
And then you have, like, the natural light in the mansion.
Oh, it's beautiful. You got the wood.
Like, the wood,
the
yeah,
glass,
so it feels like you're out in nature.
But it's a beautiful
like,
green. It's mm-hmm. a lush green of nature.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just, yeah. And even, like, the green of the basement that the Kim family lives in is mm-hmm. very, like... tile and just kind of
mm-hmm. yeah
it's not great
right
the party scene oh
yeah.
man that party scene at the end that's the climax.
Did you like that's one of your favorite ones?
It's one of my favorites absolutely because it really does it's probably the most fun part mm-hmm. of the movie honestly
mm-hmm.
that's the most fun part
where everyone's getting murdered
yeah it's just like
in horrific
kinda,
ways
it turns into more of like a a parody. It's so ridiculous. Yeah. You're just like this crazy dude coming back like, yeah, I'm just stabbing people. Oh, when he goes for the second, when he hits the tutor, the son, with the rock a second time.
Yeah. Whoa. Oh, yeah.
I was like, oh my God, they're going to show that? It looks so real. I was like, I hope that extra
Well, the thing is with that, like the first time he smashes the rock, he just literally drops it.
Yeah.
On presumably his face or head.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't see it. And like, I mean, I don't know if you're familiar with this, but I remember when I was in college, I learned about the, you know, in Greek theater, they would very rarely show the violence.
It would go
on stage.
Off.
It would go off stage.
And then the narrator, somehow, the chorus would be like, and they die.
Right. Or like you'd see the evidence of it, or like you'd kind of like hear it. And like in many ways, that's so much more horrific than actually seeing it.
Because you're, like, it's your imagination. You imagine worst thing. Right. They say, imagine the worst death, and you do.
Right, exactly.
So, yeah.
And so, it was interesting to me that, like, when they showed that, I was like, I feel like there was this kind of, like, pit in my stomach. I'm like, oh. Like, you just imagine that big, heavy rock smashing his face.
The thing
you know?
Is, we, when he's still, we've
he's
seen
like,
it.
He's
we've
not
seen...
unconscious or anything. Yeah. He's, like, awake, and it goes, you know, whatever. Oh. Like, it Man. Makes you shiver, and you haven't even seen it. And then when they show it the second time.
When he comes back.
When he comes back, like, and he's, like, drops it again.
Oh, boy.
It's not as bad, but it's just interesting that they decided to also show that. And show, like, the pooling of blood and the pooling of the plum juice.
Oh,
did you
that
see that?
Was, yes, I
to
saw
get,
that.
Like, it's like water and blood.
Trust me, I clocked that. I'm a film major. I saw that. Like, symbolism. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. I really... Dang. And what's really cool is that is one of the most subversive and amazing ways to have a planting and a payoff, because the audience silently and subconsciously picks up on the fact that this is a heavy rock throughout literally the entire film.
Mm-hmm.
We kind of take it for granted, but we know people are just like,
like the
oh,
sound
this,
of the rock
this box
too.
Is so heavy. And oh, this, like, you just see them carry it. It's a heavy rock.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just such a... Oh,
yeah,
it's,
I know. See, I so think visceral. I think it's all everything happened because of the rock.
You think?
Well, yeah.
I mean, I was expecting them to like have that be more of a direct allegory, be like, it was the rock.
Well, I don't think they needed to, because literally what started them on this whole plan was that the rock was supposed to represent like good fortune,
yeah,
and like specifically
exactly.
wealth, and people were like, that's why it was gifted to them, because. Whatever his friend's grandfather wanted them to have that for, like, prosperity and everything. And, of course, that got them kind of, especially into the son, Kevin.
Yes. Kevin.
Not that it's real name, but...
Kevin and Jessica.
Yeah, right, exactly. He got it into his head that The Rock was gonna, like, fulfill that promise.
Yeah.
Like, you can tell. And he calls it, like, oh, how metaphorical. And remember how he says that again when the plan starts taking hold and they've decided to take over the household. He's like, oh, so metaphorical. It's like he's thinking back to that rock and how the rock is what's propelling them. And then when they're in the big, like, gymnasium or whatever, after the flood, he's, like, clutching it. He's like... I'm not the one who's hugging it. It's, like, clinging to me. So, like, to him, he feels like he doesn't have any power over his decision-making.
Yeah.
It's all the rock that's, like...
The rock.
That's pushing them.
Dwayne the Rock Johnson.
But then, despite, like, at the end, though, you see him put it back in a river.
Yeah.
He returns it. So it kind of makes you think that
kinda
that
like
whole,
the black
that
sand
whole
beaches
plan,
of Hawaii.
Like, the whole plan that he says to his dad, like, oh, like, I'm going to get rich one day, and I'm going to buy the house, and you'll be free.
Yeah.
And he puts the rock away. So it's kind of like, do you actually think you're going to fulfill that plan? Because, like, the rock represented you being able to carry out those plans. And
now it was always a symbol of power over others, you know?
Right.
So I think that's why I think Kevin's the arc was probably the best in the whole film for me.
Oh, yeah,
just
for sure.
Seeing that. Develop and like I think that's like kind of an independence thing of like I must create my own power, my own wealth, you know, like I need to, you know, not be a scam artist and just like genuinely give it a go.
So you think he will try and fulfill the plan?
I mean, that's the thing. The ending is very interpretive.
Mm-hmm. So, because like you see it and you're like, oh my gosh, everything's okay like, hey. Now. And then he figured it out. And then it
turns out there's one more shot in the film.
Yeah. Oh, it's like that was a dream sequence, basically.
Boy. Yeah. Yeah, I think it's really interesting. I think he does. The optimist in me is like, yeah, mm-hmm. he's going to do it. I feel like what they showed us was just a future version. Does he deserve to do it, though? I don't know.
I don't know if he deserves it.
I don't think he does.
I don't think he deserves it. Or the dad, for that matter. None of them really do.
They don't.
They don't deserve the happiness.
But I feel like we're supposed to be, you know, kind of... We're still supposed to feel bad for them. Like, I still end up feeling bad for them, mm-hmm. you know? And, like, kind of wanting them to be happy. Mm-hmm. You know, because at the end of the day, they are a flawed family. Mm-hmm. But they're still, like, just trying to provide for each other and just be happy in life. So in that sense, I'm like, yeah, go you guys. but also, you're kind of assholes. mm-hmm. Yeah. The sausage skewer being the weapon of choice. Not even a skewer. It's a straight-up sword. They just sword chose a sword like, to, like...
chock full of meat that yeah, then gets stabbed.
Sidestab the crazy basement
right
husband.
Right
through his guts. Mm-hmm. Oh, awesome.
He's smiling, too, even yeah. when he's dead. He's like...
he's like...
Hey. Like twitching and yeah. oh my dying. God. But then, like, I think his... This is a conversation I had with my friend who I went to go see this originally, is his relationship with Mr. Park.
Oh, his like, you know? His fanaticism?
Yeah, his fanaticism. Like, that like, I find oh. so interesting that he's, like, grateful to him, that he, like, quote-unquote, took care of him.
Yeah.
And, like, allowed him to have this good life that he thinks that he's had. And then when Mr. Park goes up to him, obviously he's, like, never seen him, and he, like, kind of has that reaction. He's like, yeah. who are you? Like, why are you here? And he's like, oh, Mr. Park, like, he's, like, seen, finally, like, in person, this man that mm-hmm. he's idolized. And then he's kind of like, oh, like, whatever. And then he's like, respect.
Yeah.
And like, what does that mean? Like.
Yeah.
For who? Respect from?
You like, the crazy man respect, bro.
Respect, bro. Yeah.
Yo, mad yo, respect, bro.
Yeah. Almost a part, that's partly what it makes me think of. But then I'm like. Yeah, I don't know. I just think that's interesting, that final line that he has before yeah, he dies.
Before he just goes
and then he rolls banana. Him over and takes the keys from his dead body.
Oh, the smell.
And then he, like,
the idea of, like, help, class yeah. struggle with, like, literally smell. Yeah. I think that's what does it for Mr.
Kim.
Well,
yeah.
For the dad. Like, he's like, that's like, what does it, like, mm-hmm. oh, it's anyone. Mm-hmm. It's anyone lower than them. The smell mm-hmm. disgusts the upper class. Oh, mm-hmm. I love that. That was really like good.
Classic.
Yeah. I feel like you see kill throughout the entire rich. Second half of the...
Down
yeah.
with the bourgeoisie.
That's exactly. Down with the bourgeoisie. Long live the proletariat. Bernie 2020. No. We are all broadcasting from Burlington, Vermont today. No.
In case you didn't notice. Devastated by the news earlier
yes,
today.
Yes, we heard. It's been a tough time for a lot of my Vermonter friends mm-hmm. who were really on board. Anyways, moving on. One scene that I think really actually misdirected me as to like, because like I'm always kind of actively mm. trying to figure out what the plot is going to be with mm. some movies. Like sometimes you're like, oh, I kind of know where it's going, like because the movie wants you to know. But sometimes, mm-hmm. you know, it actively says like, hey, I want mystery. I want you to mm-hmm. not know what's going to happen mm-hmm. yet. And it's actually the scene when he's driving. Mr. Kim is driving Mr. Park, mm-hmm. And they're kind of like talking about. So they just fired the housekeeper.
Yep.
And he gives him the business card, mm-hmm. the fake business card that they made up. Like, hey, hire my wife. Wink, wink. You know, kind of thing. When in that scene, and he says, "Do you still love your wife? Mm-hmm. Like, do you love her?" And he's like, "Well, yeah, of course." And I really thought in that moment, I thought I had the whole movie figured out, where they would eventually tear the Park family apart and literally replace them. Mm-hmm. Like they would try and get like the daughter or the housekeeper to like have an affair and like kick mm-hmm. out. Cause like they always kind of describe the Mrs. Park as like kind of simple, but nice.
Yeah.
So she's easy to get rid of.
Yep.
And you have both of the kids working with the rich kids, you right. know, as in a tutor and in like a therapy sense. So there's control. Mm-hmm. And I feel like I was really expecting them to kind of take like a whole control mm-hmm. angle over like, this is just our life now.
Yeah.
And then it didn't go that way.
I know. It's kind of, I mean, that's where I thought it was going originally too. I was yeah. like, oh, they're going to like take over and they're going to do some really creepy stuff to like mm-hmm. replace this family and probably like murder them and everything. But that's yeah. definitely not that's what happened. That's not
what happened. No. I appreciate it. If it went mm-hmm. either way, I still would have appreciated it. Mm-hmm. So I think it's really cool in that sense. Yeah. You know? For sure.
So least favorite?
Least favorite parts? Anything? Anything that stuck out to you? Like, oh, why was that there? Well,
I mean, not really.
I mean, that's the thing. There's so much about this mm-hmm. film that just, for me, it's not a matter of they put in stuff that wasn't great. It's what they, you know, it sometimes lacks.
Okay.
You know, yeah. when mm-hmm. you literally have 10 characters that mm-hmm. you're all trying to follow and understand the mm-hmm. like mm-hmm. the character arcs of mm-hmm. people drop by the wayside mm-hmm. so you kind of lose that, like, I wanted to see what happened with the alt of the son of the rich kid who's supposed to be like this autistic whatever savant whatever and like mm-hmm. alt therapy, and like, I'll be honest, I'm looking at his alt, I'm kind of impressed. I'm like, wow, this kid actually has some talent, this is really cool. But also he keeps drawing the same thing over and over, the ghost, right. which yeah. I think is the ghost, air quotes, right. over the radio, the ghost.
Right.
Every time you see it, it's the human form, and it's the big eyes, the crazy yeah. eyes, and like kind of the dark. Mm-hmm. I thought that was really cool.
I didn't notice that.
But actually. It doesn't go anywhere. He never ends up being important to that final scene. It's just his birthday, mm-hmm. and he just kind of like he faints. Does he have a seizure again? Because he sees probably. The ghost?
I feel like that's kind of assumed.
Yeah.
I don't think he's actually having a seizure, but... You know, she was all like, we can't wait for an ambulance. We need to get, because she remember how she was saying that they can't.
Exactly.
He has to get there soon. So, mm-hmm.
like 15 minutes is what right. you said, the time you well, have, I guess. Or
I mean, I didn't really feel like they needed to go any further with the art because it kind of felt like it was a sham. Like,
yeah.
It was like obvious.
Just
that
to get in.
Just yeah. to get in, right? And she was kind of like feeding that. But it is interesting, though, that, like, kind of subtly, maybe not subtly, that, yeah, he was drawing the crazy man from the basement mm-hmm. the entire time. Yeah. Over and over again.
Over and over, yeah. Because again, yeah. like that incident really defined mm-hmm. him, you know. Yeah, like every once in a while, I'm watching. Mm-hmm. I'm like, this just has some open holes, mm-hmm. some plot mm-hmm. holes that never get filled. Mm-hmm. You know, so it's what they don't add or what they forget to like tie off is mm-hmm. what kind of gets it for me.
Yeah.
But I do want to end on this. I think overall favorite shot of the film, if you have a favorite shot, we'll end on favorite shot of the film. Mine is Mr. Kim walking out from the climax above shot tracking as he leaves
and he goes down, you see all the carnage around him.
Exactly.
Mm-hmm.
I think that it's just the most aesthetically pleasing shot for me.
Mm-hmm.
It's the most emotionally gratifying. But yeah, for me, that's that.
Interesting.
You?
Favorite shot? Trying to think. Well, one that makes me laugh is when, like, Jessica is videoing the peeing / whatever,
oh my God.
Throwing right. buckets of water.
The peeing in buckets slow of water motion. Scene, yeah.
I mean, that's just a totally humorous one. And with the classical music, duh.
Yeah.
Just like,
it's funny. I feel like that completely went yeah. over me that they were literally getting pissed on
yeah.
in this movie.
Yeah.
It's literally like a plot device. It's like, right. yeah, let's have this dude urinate on their house.
Right. Exactly.
Yeah.
But if I had to think maybe more seriously of like a shot that I really enjoy, I mean, one that like really sticks with me is like, again, the guy from the basement coming up
ooh.
Over it. It's just like so yeah. haunting. So, but then, yeah, no, I think
that one
sticks out the
that's
most.
That's a solid choice.
Yeah.
It's an A+ choice.
Thanks.
In conclusion, mm-hmm. good movie. Worth a watch if you're interested in watching a movie mm-hmm. about some relatable class struggle mm-hmm. And the inherent grit and grime of humanity in the family dynamic in the modern world, anything else that this movie covers? Indians? American Indians?
Bigger plot point than you think.
Yeah, no, you'd be surprised. yeah, well, this wraps it up for this week. Mm-hmm. Thank you so much for listening. Thank you so much, Julia, joining me.
You're welcome.
Yeah.
Happy to be here. Look forward to our next installment.
Yes, eventually. I hope we can have more down the pipe in the coming months. A quick message out to Connor. I hope all is well. We're thinking about you back here at the Film and headquarters in Burlington. Stay safe. Stay happy. Keep watching movies. As always, I will promote, since he's not here, I will promote Connor's Letterboxd Cranberry 18. That is C-R-A-N-D Berry 18. All right. Thank you guys for listening, and see you next time.